and done in, is done in Excel. And Excel is Excel. So we know it's limited. It does everything we need it to do. It just doesn't do it as friendly as we'd like it to do. So I don't know how long this will take, but we'll soon we'll get finished with the forecasting part, and at the end we'll do some Tableau stuff. And Tableau what we did last week, and then it'll set us up to be able to Tableau what we do in the forecasting also. So export Attestata into Excel. Excel goes directly into Tableau. If you noticed, I sent you an email right before class. Mm-hmm. So that's your Tableau license. Although I think someone told me that you can get a year-long trial from Tableau.
If you go on their site.
Yeah, if you just go on their site and sign up for the academic version, you get a year-long, which to be honest is better than what I give you, because I think the one they give me is just for the semester, the duration of the semester. All right, get ready for the awesomeness. Make sure you took your heart medication. We just finished tasting rooms. That was six. So this must be seven. Of course, this changes. All right, so here's our data. As I have it set up right now, I think it's all ready to go. Date is a date. Let's check it out first. Yeah, everything's all ready to go. I may give you the raw data, simply because I think the more times you have to, and the only thing you'll have to do is take date, which will be a string, and convert it to date, which is a numeric in Stata. But we've done that before, so we know how to do that. Again, one of the criticisms I had of you guys was, you guys are really, really smart. You know how to do the analytics. But the data's got to be in the format like class. It's got to be given to you in the perfect format. So the more times I could just throw stuff in there that you have to fix, I think the better. The more you get used to having to realizing that data isn't always ready to go out of the box. So I think we'll do that. So let me do this one thing also. And I think we can generate time too, but I'm going to drop it. And regenerate. All right, and we can pull out month and year, all that good stuff. Let's take a look at the data. I probably shouldn't have done that. Okay. Let's see. This is just a graph. I'm not sure if this is the data we've already looked at.
It looks like it.
It's the same period because that's just the data that I have. It looks, most of the red wines are going to have the same seasonality. This has, are going to have the exact same seasonality. And as you saw, when we look at all wines are going to follow pretty much that same shape. So, so here's the data. What we're going to do is what we've already gotten halfway there. So what we're going to do is, one, model this existing data set, which we already know how to do, and we'll do it again. And then two, we're going to want to take the data from here and extend it into the future. That's what the forecast is. And the assumption is, kind of the underlying assumption is, if we're comfortable with how well the data fits, how well our model fits the current data, then we should be comfortable with how well the model projects into the future, which we don't know is going to happen in the future. So step one is being able to predict the past, which is kind of easy, but it's easier than predicting the future. So we can all predict, you know, the winners of the past Super Bowls. The hard part is predicting the winner of the next Super Bowl, which some people forget. Okay, so let's do that. And we did this, I think this was the first or second thing we did in this class. We know there's a time trend, and let's generate that variable because it looks like I need it. So let's generate time equals underscore n. And all that gives us is the numeric one through whatever. So the data is already sorted by time, and we're just going to use that time variable to create the numeric one through however many periods we have. And we have 83 periods. Yeah, we need this. Okay, so we can do that. Bless you. That was a sneeze, it was a cough. And I take my bless you back. We know that there are two things. There's a time trend, and then there's the monthly seasonality. So in our regression, and again, we did this already, I think this is different, because those numbers look a little bit different. But I don't know off the top, I don't remember off the top of my head. So the time trend is, the coefficient on time represents the time trend. It looks like cases are growing about 326 per period. And we see the coefficients on all of the monthly dummies are statistically significant except for December, which means that all months are statistically different from the omitted month of January, except for December. So December and January don't appear to be statistically distinguishable between each other. The constant, again, doesn't have much of an interpretation. It essentially says, when everything's zero, including time, at the year zero, that's what cases would have been. Again, we don't really care about that because we're not going to go back to the zero period. So, good looking model. R squared, which is our adjusted R squared, is really nice. It's nice and high. It's 93. I think this is a different data set. I don't remember if we got that out before.
Can we turn off a light?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, yeah, we want to be able to. To get the mood right.
Yeah.
So much better.
That? Or one more?
One more.
What?
It's too dark.
Too dark?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Better.
Better?
Is that okay for the camera?
Yeah, that's good.
Good?
Okay. Yeah, check the
check it. Got the mood right? Okay.
Yeah, I think we're good.
Now you gotta readjust your.
Yeah, we're fine.
So this is our model. We're, well, at least it looks, on paper, or at least numerically it looks good. We really want to compare it to the actual data. Again, our R squared isn't always the best measure. The best measure is usually visually. Is the model fitting the data well? And I've seen. So we're going to predict, save our regression output. So predict cases hat, that saves our regression output. And then we're just going to show the two series together, which we've, again, already done before. So this is already, this is homework two, right? Yeah, it looks pretty good. You know, the peaks, we kind of catch up. We miss some of the peaks, but you know, let's not nitpick. If there's one period that we weren't too good at predicting, it was that first period. But the model, regression is really a, it's a learning process. So the model gets better as it goes along. And other than that first period, it's pretty accurate. So we're confident with our R squared. 93% means 93% of the variation in sales is explained by our model, which is simply time and seasonal variation, our monthly dummies. So 93% of the variation in sales is explained by our relatively simple model. And we can add more stuff, but we're pretty comfortable right now. Let's see. All right. One thing we can do is to look at our model, again, to analyze our model, is to do what we did already. We can calculate the differences. So let's generate, I'm going to call it diff. And diff is just the difference between the actual and predicted values. And we did this when we were benchmarking, except we did it in Excel. I'm going to generate the percentage difference, which just means I'm going to take this difference and divide it by cases. So the difference divided by cases will give us the percentage difference. And again, we did that already, we just did it in Excel. I think we did it in Excel. Then I'm going to look. I'm going to table this. It's just a table of a lot of stuff. We don't really need all of it. There's time, there's cases, the predicted cases, the difference in cases, and the percentage difference. And essentially what we're looking at is, I think what I would care about the most is this percentage difference. If you've ever done a forecast, you're looking for kind of forecasting errors. And look what we're getting here. And again, we're not forecasting in the future yet, but our confidence in our forecast is based on how well we can predict the past. So look at this. 2%, 4%, 2%, less than 0.5%. You guys have done forecasts. You've seen forecasts done. Is that good? That's not good. That's awesome. That is mathematically awesome. Not judgmental or opinionated awesome. That's an awesome forecast. If you can get under 10% error, that's pretty good. Again, the biggest one I could see is that first one, but we knew that. And that's fine. That first period was difficult to explain, but we got better after that. Outside of that, do we see any double digits? Well,
22 and 16.
10%, yeah, those first couple.
Yeah.
So the PDIF is actually a percentage?
The what?
The mean,
yeah,
the
percentage.
Oh, I thought it was predictive. Okay, never mind, sorry.
It's
what
the P stands for.
I know.
Fail.
Yeah,
that's what
the P stands
for.
Smarty pants. And then we're just kind of scrolling down and looking to see if we see any bigger, big numbers like that. And they're all pretty good. Let's go to the end. Saw 12?
Yeah, there's a 12 up there.
Yeah, there's a 12. Okay, we got a 12.
A 13.
There's a 13. Yeah, we can summarize it too, right? We can sum PDIF. Oh my God, this is better than I thought. Look at the average. Again, given that the horrible first one, which is 16%, which isn't that bad, but the average percentage difference of our model is less than 0.5% off. That is, like I said, that is insane. That is, in the forecasting world, that's insane. And again, this is real data. I didn't cherry pick this data. This is data I picked for probably random because it was a brand I liked. Or at least I knew. We can see the largest ones. The percentiles kind of tell us what's going on. 95% of our predictions are under 7%, under 10% off. So that's, like I said, that's really good. And again, look at the midpoint. Half of them are less than 1/10 of 1%, or about 1/10 of 1%. That's pretty good. So if you can get predictions that accurate, that is pretty good. So the model had an R squared of 0.93. We said that's a pretty high. The picture, the model seems to fit the data pretty well. And then the errors seem to be pretty low. We're pretty confident in our ability to predict the past, which means it should give us more confidence in predicting the future. Assuming there's no cataclysmic event. So, a 9/11, a financial crisis, those kinds of things are going to throw off most forecasts. But assuming we don't get any kind of event like that, if the next year, and we're going to forecast for a year, if the next year is similar to the last however many years this is, then we're pretty confident.
What if you weren't confident in forecasting?
Yeah, then we'd have to fix our model. We'd have to try to do something with our model. So, for example, some of the stuff we could have done is, so here's our model. Our model is pretty good, but it's pretty simple also. We're saying that 93% of the variation in sales is explained by two things, a long-term time trend and seasonal variation. Now, there are other things that affect sales, for example, income, right? The overall GDP, the economy. And if your product is, let's see, this was 2011. So this is 2007 to 11, so this was during the financial crisis. And we didn't really see much of a dip. But if your product was more sensitive to income changes than this product obviously is, then we're probably going to throw income in. And we can pull income from a variety of sources, and we may actually do that to show how income is, how your product is affected by changes in income. And the cool thing about that is once we throw in income, and we can think of income as an overall measure of the economy. Once we do that, we can do, well, we can do that with this too. We can do kind of scenario planning. We can say if the economy continues as it has been growing, all right, so we can do this. So here's time, and here's the end of the data. So now we have a before and after. And we can say this. If the economy continues as it has in the past, which is really the assumption we're making now, then we can expect the forecast to continue along that same trend. Again, including the seasonal variations. But we can also do some scenario changes. We can say, well, what if we expect the economy to pick up, right? Then we would expect our sales to increase. So if you're a big Trump supporter, we're going to make America great again, and the economy's going to boom, and we're all going to be billionaires and have our own reality shows, then maybe sales do that. If you're an anti-Trump person, the Antichrist has arrived, and we can expect sales to do that. But we can do those things. We can literally model these into our forecast. We can say if the economy continues in the same way, it's going to go that way. If the economy is going to grow, we can expect sales to grow by this much. If the economy is going to tank, we can expect sales to fall by this much. And we can specify this. And this is where kind of these opinions go. Well, I think the economy is going to grow by 5% or 10%. So I'm going to include in my forecast let's say this was, let's say this is, I don't know what it is, but let's say this is a 2% growth rate. I think the economy is going to grow by 5%. Or it's going to fall by, you know, 7% or something. So we can add in those scenarios and see what's going to happen. You know, they used to call that, at least when I was in college, they used to call that what-if scenarios. Now they're called contingency scenarios, or what's another term to use for that? It used to be what-if tables in Excel that do that kind of stuff. But so we can do that. But let's do the simple one first. And the one we're going to do now is really this one. We're going to say, if things continue, then we can expect this to happen. If things continue in the future like they have in the past, then we can expect this to happen. But most firms will do a contingency analysis. What if this happens? What if that happens? Because really no one can predict what's going to happen in the future. All right, we're pretty comfortable with our model. let's start our forecast. Any other questions? You guys look scared for some reason.
What?
Yeah, it's, it doesn't look like a confident. All right. So, one thing we're going to do is this. One way to test the model, let's go back to my graph. One way to test the model is to do this. Because we don't know, we won't know it until the future if our model was right or wrong. So what we're going to do is do what's called a holdback sample. We're going to run... We're going to cut off the data. Let's say let's cut it off right here. I'm only going to use this much of the data, up to 92. And then I want to see if I can forecast 2010. I was going to say 93. It's 2009. I want to see if I can forecast 2010 or 11. So we're comfortable with our model. We're going to do a holdback sample, which means we're going to run a regression on just this much data. So we're going to have to tell this data, don't use all the data. And then we're going to try to forecast the future. Because remember, the regression is going to only include that holdback sample. And then we're going to see, okay, let's assume that we were in July 1st, 2009. How would our prediction have been onward from there? And then we'll be able to check it because we kind of have the answers in the back of the book. We can go back and say, yeah, we did get the answers right. Or we were way off. And in that case, we'd have to, again, fudge the model or something. So this is how we test the model. We see, okay, can we predict the past? Hold back sample, rerun the regression, try to forecast an error, a period that we already know. And then just see how well we forecast. Again, if we're confident with that, then we can be confident with our forecast of the true future. And again, this data set ends in 2011, so I don't think I have this data past that, so we'll be able to do that. So let's do a holdback sample, and let's hold back, so let's do this. We know there are 83 periods, let's hold back the final 13, the last year. Let's hold back the last year. And we can see there, 83 periods. We can do the math, 83 minus 13 is 70. And we're gonna run a regression on just those 70 periods. So you tell us data, don't use all the data, just use those first 70 periods. Adjusted R-squared goes down a bit, but that's fine because we don't have as many observations. We know that the more data you have, the better your models tend to be. So Our growth rate's a little bit different, but we still get the same essential results. Time is significant. T is well over 2. All of our monthly dummies are statistically significant except for December, which we had before also. So we're, again, we'd be happy with an R-squared of 91.
So which, what years are included in this?
Up to 2009, right?
Oh, okay.
I thought it was 11, so we can do that.
I thought we cut it off at 2009.
Oh, in this
we cut off 13 period.
Yeah.
Is there a reason December is not significant?
Yes. Can you remember why?
Is it because of the seasonality, because they're closer together? I have no idea.
Kind of, but we said that it's
peaks
kind of
like the November season. Like, aren't the peaks closer together, so the sales difference is going to be
a little bit, but it's the nature of the data. Remember, this is 4-week ending data and not true monthly data. So
that's the one low.
The Christmas data, a lot of the time, is going to get carried over into the week after Christmas. So, yeah.
Okay, cool, thank you.
And remember, this is Nielsen / IRI data, so this is how the data is. So this isn't unique to wine, this would be the same for toothpaste or every other product that's sold through the retail sector. So this is just the nature of the data. And the reason why they do that is because there's not always 4 weeks in a month, but there's always 52 weeks in a year. So they break those 52 weeks into their 28 days. Yeah.
What is the I in I month again?
The I month is our way of not having to create 11 dummy variables for each month. Okay. Remember, we had to do that. We did that one at a time.
Yep.
And then my hands cramped up, and I said, "Oh, we should kind of go this." I remembered that there was an easier way. And so essentially, it doesn't create the dummies, but it creates them for the regression. So, and we don't need them other than for the regression. Okay, so here is our holdback sample. So we held back a year, and we're gonna try to forecast that final year. Does it make sense what we're doing? The whole concept of a holdback period?
So the time 71 is the number of periods you're including in that regression.
70 periods, yeah.
70
time less than 70.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So there's 83 periods. I'm saying only use the first 70. We're going to hold back to those final 13 and forecast them, and then see how well our forecast is. So it's like we're going to forecast the future. But we're going to be able to test our forecast, which we won't be able to do in the real future, until the real future occurs. So again, we're just going to predict this, we're going to save it, and it'll just, again, it's a regression based on our holdback period.
Are you saying
holdback
period or holdback period?
Holdback.
Holdback.
Okay.
Holdback,
yeah, we're literally holding back some of the data.
Why do we want to predict it before we tease
it? You don't have to. I'm just trying to figure out where my predict is. There it is. Prediction is a post-regression command, so I could do anything other than a regression, and it'll still remember the last regression. So, cases hat 1 is our regression based on our holdback period regression. The nice thing about the predict command is that even though the regression was only for the first 70 periods, it'll predict for any periods that exist in the data. What the heck does that mean? It means that, let's go over here. So remember that we only ran a regression based on data for the first 70 periods. But because our data includes those final 13, It actually runs the regression and forecasts. So these final 13 periods, right, from 71 to 83, are predictions based on a regression of the first 70. So those final 13 predictions are true forecasts of what we're pretending to be the future, right? And the future, for, we can't see the dates. Looks pretty close, yeah. So, yeah, and let's do kind of what we did before. Let's calculate the difference and see how the forecast.
And that just fills in by saving it with the predict. So just build in those 13.
Exactly. Oh. So predict does exactly that. It predicts for us. So even though we only use the first 70, it's going to predict for all the observations. Wow. Question?
I was just getting clarification.
About?
So it does predict for the last 13 periods in the sound progression, basically.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, so let's do the same thing we did before. We're going to compare our actual and predicted values. But yeah, you can see that they look pretty close. We don't want to do math in our head, though. At least I don't want to.
Plus,
that might have been a sneeze.
So, the t-set is not what's forecasting the last 13 periods?
No, I just did that so we can start using the date function. So this is the actual and the new prediction. And I could tell that because, so this is actual cases, and then cases hat one was the regression based on the holdback period. I can't tell. I mean, it looks pretty good again. But let's compare it to. No, let's do this. One thing I like to do, and I think you've noticed it, is I like to put a vertical line. Yeah, vertical line to compare the before and after. How do you do that?
Yeah.
Excellent. Let's do it. The command is really easy. But the hard part is getting the date. So if we list, so list date. So the last period of the forecast is April 3rd, 2010. So we want to put a vertical line there. I'm sorry, the last period of the actual data. So essentially, we have to unformat it, and that's that. That's this. So this is going to make the data look like numbers again. Okay. So we're going to unformat the data. And then we want to know essentially what the end of the data was. So it'll be, well, we can't see it now, but we. But we know this. Okay. So we know this, that the regression used data up until this period, right? So the forecast starts here. So we want to use, I guess we can use either one of these, but we want to use one of those for the forecast to demarcate the difference between the actual data and the forecasted data. And that turned out to be April 3rd. So we do this. Bless you. So April 3rd was 18,355 days since January 1st, 1960. So we need that number. And then we're going to reformat it. So now if we list it, it'll list it as a date again. So that percent, where'd it go? What's up? Yeah. The percent 9.0G reformats it as a number. We want that number so we can show the vertical line. And then we're going to reformat it back as a date. And that is going to be, yeah, percent D, or TD. So, go ahead.
I'm just trying to read it because I can't without squinting. Got it. Never mind.
My graph. So to put that, essentially what it is a line along the x-axis on the date that we want to put it like that. So we just want that vertical line along the x-axis. We can also do a line along the y-axis. But for now, we want a line along the x-axis. Anyone want to guess what the command for a line along the x-axis is?
X-axis line.
Close, x-line.
X-line.
Yeah, so it's even easier. Axes would take too much time to detect. And you can see it there. We know the number, so x-line and then tell it where. Now, I think Stato should be able to let us use the date functions to do the x-lines, but they don't listen to me. They're still mad that I keep giving away Stato. So we get that nice x-axis line. That's it. And we can change the color and do all kinds of stuff.
You have three. You actually have three in there.
Yeah, there's three. So the red is from the full regression, the regression that used all 83 observations. The green dotted line is from the holdback regression. And what I want to see is how different my holdback regression is from my full regression. And it looks like they're pretty close.
Can you go back to the command and say that you just did?
The scatter command?
Yeah.
It's the same scatter command we've been using for a couple weeks now.
No, we just kind of want to see where the X line goes, and it just goes at the end?
Anywhere in there.
Anywhere? Okay.
This is kind of a zoom. So basically I said, give me the periods after the X line. So date after April 3rd, 2010. So this time, and again, we're trying to zoom in on the forecast period. So there's the actual data. Remember, the red is the full regression using all 83 observations, including the observations in this holdback period. And then the green dotted is the regression that only used the data before this holdback period.
So that's the actual prediction then, the green dots?
So that would have been our prediction if we didn't know the future.
Okay.
Is it a whole lot different than our prediction when we did know the future?
It's pretty good.
So this is a way of testing our model to see how confident are we going to be in predicting the future. Because in essence, we did predict the future. We didn't have this data when we constructed this forecast. Now, we had it when we constructed this forecast. And again, you can see it's a little bit better, right? This is closer to the actual than the green. But it's not anything that I think you would cry about. You'd be worried about. You'd be concerned about.
Can you go back to how you made it just this part?
I just said graph if period after 70. I think you were again typing while I was showing him that.
I gotta write my notes.
Well, you got to pay attention, too, so you can do one of two things. Date after the pullback period, yeah. Okay, so we can do the same thing we did before. Construct the difference. Again, hat one is our holdback period forecast. And then we're going to construct the P difference one. And then just kind of peruse through. All right, PDIF1 is, again, it was bad. It was bad in the first regression where we had the data. It's bad in the holdback regression. Yeah. Actually, I probably should have done this. We have these. This should be PDIF. So we can compare. I think that makes more sense. So now these are the percentage differences from both models. Did I put a 1 on it? Yeah. Okay, so this just wants PDIF without that. All right, so remember PDIF is the model based on all of the data. And PDIF1 is the model based on less a subset of the data, the whole back sample. Mm-hmm. And surprisingly, those first ones are actually better. But those were outliers, so I wouldn't worry about that. But if you go through, you can see that there is a difference. This is a little bit lower, 4% versus 5%. This one's a little bit bigger. This one's a little bit bigger. This one's a little bit smaller. So there is a difference, but we saw they were pretty close. And if we were to do a test of statistical differences, the average difference probably wouldn't be a whole lot different between the two. And we can do that. So let's do that. So sum, actually we can do this. Means PDIF and PDIF. Let's see. Our main interest is the arithmetic mean. And why is this funny? Someone describe what's going on here. The average, remember the average difference from our first model when we used all 83 observations was 0.003, less than 0.5%. The average difference for our holdback sample is actually less. It's actually better. That's an anomaly. That's strange. I think it's because those first we were so off on those first few predictions, and we were less off on those predictions in the second. Either way, we're pretty confident in predicting the future. Does that make sense?
Can you explain how you did the PDIF one just really briefly?
Just like the first one.
Exactly like the first one. So it's going to be the predicted, the actual one is the predicted. First, I constructed the difference between actual and predicted, and then I just took that and divided it by cases, and that gives us a percentage difference.
So it's only one equals, huh?
Yeah. Double equals is when you're specifying, like a graph or something like that.
In cases, what is our regression?
Excuse me?
Second regression.
Is our holdback sample.
Yeah.
Is
our holdback sample.
The predicted values from our holdback sample. So, we go through all that. Again, we can go back to the picture. We go through all that, and we're pretty comfortable in our prediction. Again, the green dotted line represents a prediction based on data that ended before this April 10th to April 11th data. So this gives us confidence in predicting the future. Questions? students, I guess someone's another state tries to predict students. Airlines predict the passengers. Sometimes they're wrong and they overbook. Sometimes they're wrong and they underbook. What do they do when they overbook?
Travel vouchers.
Yeah, I've seen them come out of the lobby with a stack of cash.
What?
$100 bills.
What?
Who wants to take the next plane? $100? $200? It's a game. Have you never seen that before?
Oh, yeah. It depends on where you are and what time of year it is as to whether people take them up on it.
Yeah, and eventually they'll just keep whipping out 300.
Whichever.
Boom. Yeah.
So our initial regression model, the adjusted R-squared was 93%, and that's the variation in sales.
Explained by our model.
And our model is based on seasonal variance.
And a time trend.
And time trend?
And the time trend, okay. So the fact that you don't see that happen very often means that they're pretty good. And airlines have been doing this stuff. Again, it's a big deal for airlines. Because they got to come out there with cash and start paying people to take the next plane. Okay, so what we want to do now is actually forecast the future. Let's see, here's our forecast. So we want to add... Remember what I said about the predict command will fill in for the data set for the variables that we're predicting. So in essence, this kind of goes back to the question he just asked. Our model includes two things. Time, there's got to be a date. We're using time, which is here. And then we need to fill in these months, right? So we're going to fill in for the next 13 periods. So we need to find the next 28-day period here, the next 28-day period here, the four-week ending period here, the next four-week ending period here, and so on and so on. So we need to fill this in. We need to fill in, we're not using date, so we don't need to fill that in, although we could. We are using month, though, so we need to fill in these months. So this is going to go, what, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then 1, and so on. You see what we have to do? Mm-hmm. So we need to fill in date, time, and month, because our model has time and month in it, right? So anything that the model has in it, we need to make sure that it's there for Stata to fill in. And if it doesn't... if we don't fill those in, the model won't predict for the future. So the model is only going to predict for the future values of the variables in the model. It seems kind of confusing, but it makes sense. So we need to extend this data set. We could... count 28 days, and then another 28 days here, another 28 days here, boom, and then again we can do the months. The months are easy, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then 1, 2, 3, and then time is easy. We're just going to add, you know, 13 to this, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, all that kind of stuff. That's kind of a pain.
I wish there was an easier way.
Yeah. So Stata's actually thought of that before. They've come up with that. And the command tset the data, which we really haven't had to do. And then use... TS append, and then you literally tell it, we're going to add date to the data set, and then it asks you how many. or you tell it how many, at 13 periods. We're gonna forecast for the next year, which in Nielsen / IRI years are 13 four-week ending periods.
So you don't reset the data first, you just do TSM.
No, you have to reset the data first,
okay.
Which we already did,
okay.
But we didn't have to. That's why I think when you asked, I said, well, we didn't need it. I was kind of jumping ahead to this, so.
So as long as we look back, okay.
So if it's not TSET, I think it'll literally tell you data is not TSET. I think that's the.
How do you know when you TSET, like which variables to put in your little TSET command?
In this case, since we don't have, it's just time, so we just use TSET date.
Okay.
But we have to use the delta 28. We have to tell it the periodicity. Let's see. There's no way I can find that. But I think we did this in the other one.
Was in the homework from 2 weeks ago when we tried to TSET with just date, it wouldn't work, and so we had to include another variable.
Because
it's very confusing.
I don't think we had made that one into numbers. And that's why.
And here's why, because what we had, if you tried to TSET that data, you got more than you got multiple observations per time period, and that's because what was the data set again? What were you doing?
That was the one where we had.
Is it this one?
We had like location number.
Okay.
Blah, blah, blah,
so we had multiple locations per period.
On one date.
And in that case, you had to identify the location and the date. But remember, location couldn't be a word, it had to be
a number.
So we had to encode it. And that was all that stuff. In this case, we don't have that problem.
Easy.
Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, this begins with the right date, but this TSET only goes as far as March 31st, that's the last date on there, was like April 3rd.
Because we just added it, we already added it.
The thing was done first.
Yeah.
And, okay, that's.
But it was already TSET, I just wanted to show
but
you.
But it has to be done, that has to be done first before the append, and then if you did it again, you would see that different date. Okay,
So when we do this TS append, does it actually add data, or does it just add like the month and the time and the year and date and stuff?
Let's see.
So I feel like that was way too easy.
Yeah, it was way too easy. Okay. So you're right. All it does, since the data is already time set by this variable, it's going to add 13 of periods to the data set.
Like literally 13.
Exactly. We still have to generate, we still have to fill in the variables that are in our regression, which are months and time. So we just have to fill in these two things here.
Why would we need to fill in? Well, I guess we're predicting the cases.
Exactly, because we need to Stata needs to know that you're going to. I was going to try standing on that, but I thought twice about it. No. Stata needs to know I'm gonna forecast for the fifth month of 2011, which will be the 84th.
So we needed to assign those numbers in order for them to tell us the cases.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. So we need to go 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then this needs to go that. But we can do that. Also, by the same way we generated those. So what we can do is just say, look, we know how we generated month and time. Let's just regenerate them. And, okay. So if you remember how we don't actually need year, but I'm gonna do year anyways. Remember how we created year? We pulled it from our date. Remember how we created month? We pulled it from our date. And then remember how we created time? We just created that numeric time series. The difference is when we first, and again, we didn't do that this time. When we first generated year, we had to use the gen command, right? But we're not going to generate new variables because they already exist. We're just going to replace them so that they fill in those blank spots. So we regenerated year, which we don't need. Again, I just want to show you what happens. We regenerated month, which we do need, and we regenerated time, which we do need, and that's why we use the replace command instead of the gen command. If I tried to use gen, what would happen? Already exists, exactly. Let's say it already exists. So let's go back. So remember the TS append, as she said, just extends the date of the data set. And then when we regenerate, because remember it's pulling, the month command pulls from the date. And the time period just extends the time period. But I also did the year command just to show you that we could have pulled year out also, even though we didn't need to.
If someone wasn't paying attention, they could screw this up real easy because that last two are both in March.
Yep.
If you kept going and try to do it by hand.
So you have to know that there's going to be there's
March, April, because
there's two 28 day periods in March exactly. So you got to do this right.
Okay, so let me ask you this question, and I think it was the very first data set you had us compare by month.
Yeah.
How do you compare by month if you've got 13 periods in a year?
What Stata did was average those 2 months together.
Okay, then why on my particular assignment was I dinged for not doing 13 periods? Because you said do it by months, and I had this big periods written on it, and I got dinged for two graphs.
Just saying.
Go way back.
Do you want to pull out your thing now so I can grade it? Or?
No, I'm just saying. If I don't want to be facing the same
know.
Situation
that
this
no
one is all I'm saying. I don't want to have apples and oranges and get dinged
no
for following the instructions.
I didn't memorize the 30 grades from six assignments ago. But I'd be happy to look at it some other time. Even right now.
I just don't want to get stuck with that on this one and the instructions. That we aren't going to do months and have it supposed to be periods or vice versa.
No, we're going to forecast periods. But we have monthly dummies. Any other questions related to something more current?
See the last thing.
No? Okay. All right. We're done. Now we rerun our regression using the full data set, no longer a holdback sample. Rerun the regression, and when we predict, it's going to fill in. Yeah, when we predict, it's going to do a prediction for all 13 of these new periods. Yeah.
By full data set, you mean like the new?
The full data set. No, because we only have cases.
Oh, because predict will add it down.
Yep. We only have cases for up until that 83rd period, April 2nd, 4-week ending period, April 2nd, 2011. But our forecast, we'll be able to forecast into the future where we don't have any data. It doesn't make any sense?
No, it does.
Okay.
You
did the head tilt thing, which is...
And which would we do regression, including the cases hat and the cases hat
it's
one?
It's going to be the exact same regression that we started with. The full regression, all 83 periods.
So times that by month.
Yep. Everything, basically we're going to rerun that regression, which is right here. Okay, so there's our regression. These are literally the exact same results we got before. Notice the number of observations. Remember the holdback sample literally held back some data. So the holdback sample literally held back some data. We tested our prediction. It came out pretty good, so we're confident in actually forecasting the future. So now we've got the full data set. This is the exact same time coefficient. It was 326. This is the exact same regression we started out with. We just didn't want to rush into a forecast until we kind of back-tested our model. That's another term of the back-testing, holdback period. That's another term of the back-testing and holdback period. I think those are the two I could pull off the top of my head. We back-tested it. We're fine. Now we're going to run predict. And when we predict, it's going to fill in the future periods that we constructed using the TS append. And again, any variable that's in the regression, we had to fill in. So we had two things, we really only have two things in the regression, time and months. We replaced those.